In today's Behind the Beauty, I want to talk about the iconic brand La Mer. I'm a little bit sick, so please bear with me. I may not be as like fluidy as usual. Whilst La Mer doesn't interest me as a consumer, like I don't want to buy their products, I've heard really nice things about them. One thing that has always intrigued me about La Mer is the brand's alleged history. Today, La Mer has cemented itself as like the go-to luxury skincare brand for celebrities and rich people, basically. Britney Spears, Jennifer Lopez, Nicole Kidman, even Dwayne The Rock Johnson has been seen to be using them. They're always appearing on like Harper's Bazaar, like Go To Bed With Me. But as well as their expensive price points, they're also known for their kind of bizarre brand origins, conspiracy theories, and intrigue. With exploding rockets, bizarre tape recordings, and even a psychic medium being all part of the brand's uprising, it's understandable how La Mer have built this almost cult-like following. Chapter 1, The Origins of La Mer. The story begins with La Mer's mysterious creator, Dr. Max Huber. Dr. Huber was supposedly, apparently, working as an aerospace physicist in California, where he was allegedly involved in a lab accident whilst working on like a rocket stabilizer, and this was at some point during the 1950s. The details are kind of unclear because no kind of like real accident report was ever made, but Huber claimed that he suffered really bad chemical burns from this accident as a result, and after the accident, he tried every skincare product he could find on the market, try and help heal himself. Everything from cosmetics to medication, he could not find anything to successfully heal his burns. This is when he decided he's gonna invent the cure for himself. And he actually left his job in search for this cure, which kind of sounds a little bit odd to me, but he spent 12 years conducting his own research with over 6,000 experiments to try and find a solution, slowly refining his process until he found the perfect solution. His perfected formulation. And at the core of Huber's experimentations was what now we know to be the creation of the trademarked Miracle Broth. Whilst he was doing his research, Huber was actually living on the coast of San Diego, and he was inspired by the sea, you know, he was inspired by the regenerative properties of marine life, and he believed that the ocean's resources must hold the key to his potent healing elixir that he wanted to create. And specifically, he focused on the regenerative properties of sea kelp, which honestly nowadays is one of my favorite ingredients. And he noticed that there was like sea kelp growing by his home, right, by the waters near his home, and he noticed that this sea kelp was growing at a substantial rate every day. According to his own observations, this sea kelp was growing up to 3 feet per day. So he began experimenting with sea kelp's healing properties. And he discovered that when this sea kelp is fermented with specific ingredients, it can transform into a bioavailable form that is easily absorbed into the skin. So he developed this like unique process that involved fermenting the sea kelp along with various other ingredients, including calcium, magnesium, potassium, iron, lecithin, vitamin C, E, and B12, and various oils such as citrus, eucalyptus, wheat germ, alfalfa, and sunflower. His fermentation process took about 3 to 4 months to complete, and also involved, which was considered at the time to be some very unusual techniques. Huber believed that the use of sound waves and flashes of light could increase the potency in his miracle broth. Each new batch of this broth would be exposed to a specific sequence of pulsing lights, whilst a sound recording would play of the bubbling noise from the previous batch of broth during its fermentation process. He would also start each new batch of broth with a small amount of the previous batch, like some kind of strange seaweed sourdough starter. Now, this may sound kind of weird, but I believe that this is kind of linked to ultrasonic wavelengths. I'm gonna have to do a bit more research into this because without being a chemist myself or understanding how to formulate things or the science behind it, it's kind of hard to read. But changing the molecular structure of ingredients by using sound waves isn't necessarily the crazy thing. But apparently his what was considered strange method worked very, very well. He would use this miracle broth as almost like the base of his healing cream, then combine that with more traditional and natural ingredients that you would often see in creams. Huber would be his own test subject. He would test his cream on his own skin, his own chemical burns, slowly over the years, kind of like refining the process. And he finally landed on this winning combination, this winning formulation that apparently had managed to heal the burns on his skin from this mysterious lab accident. accident that there's no evidence ever happened. And with that, La Mer's iconic hero first product was born. Huber decided to name this Crème de la Mer, which translates to cream of the sea, advertising this cream as a soothing, nourishing, and regenerative skin healing cream, really capitalizing on the healing properties of the fermentation process. Dr. Huber began selling this cream in 1965. And you know, talking about how Crème de la Mer only used the highest quality natural skincare ingredients, how the sea kelp was hand harvested from these like pristine waters, you know, it was all very luxurious from the outset. Chapter 2, establishing his cult. Huber's bold claims regarding the healing power of his cream worked. It worked very, very well. Huber started selling his cream, his miracle cream, just on like a little storefront, just by his home, you know, very local, mainly selling it to friends and family. But in no time, he managed to get his product into some of the biggest department stores in California, and later the rest of the US would be stocking Crème de la Mer. But it was Huber himself who was actually kind of the real driving force behind growing sales and the mystique behind Crème de la Mer. He had what was reported to be a magnetic and engaging presence. He had this real quirky personality that would gain the attention of really high profile clients and customers, along with celebrities throughout the US. He would attend all the exclusive dinner parties where he would demonstrate his products and kind of promote them in these like really captivating ways. So like imagine you go to like the Oscars after party and someone's there selling skincare kind of thing. Fashion designer Ralph Rucci, who became a friend of Huber's, spoke about their first meeting in 1988. At an elite dinner party in New York, he says Max became hypnotic, telling his story. He had a small vial of Crème de la Mer at everyone's place setting. He told us all, put some in your mouth, eat it, it's great for your digestion. Rucci said, I had glasses on and Max said to me, do you have problems seeing? Take a small bit of this, dab your finger in water and put it in your eye. He went around the table performing these miraculous moments and a cult formed. He was a dazzling, brilliant man with so much charisma, always the life of the party, the center of attention. Everyone thought that they had found the fountain of youth when they found Max. It sounds really culty. He sounds like a very, very charming cult leader. This is one of Huber's favorite marketing ploys, right? He'd often encourage people to eat the cream right out of the jar or rub it on their eyes, rub it wherever somebody feels like they needed healing, this miracle healing. All actions he was happy to demonstrate himself. He would eat it, he would rub it himself, you know? Linda Wells, who at the time was an assistant at Vogue, tells a very similar story of her encounter with Dr. Huber, saying, I'll never forget it. It was bizarre. He told me the story about having chemical burns and developing the cream and wanted to demonstrate how pure it was. So he stuck his finger into it and ate it. Then he also put a finger into the cream and stuck it in his eye like it was a contact lens. There was cream all over his eye and eyelashes. It was unforgettable. I'm not sure that this is the best way to demonstrate the healing powers and benefits of a healing moisturizer, but apparently it worked for him. By the 1980s, Crème de la Mer became a skincare sensation amongst celebrities and those with money and basically anybody who could afford this new luxury skincare brand. And to his credit, it developed a really good reputation and this cult following through word of mouth primarily because of how genuinely well the product healed people's skin. And at the time, people were saying it had these genuinely amazing anti-aging properties. At the time, it was still a fairly niche product, you know, it was getting very popular, but it still had this very specific cult following that was now expanding. Until it wasn't anymore, La Mer actually stopped flying under the radar and started to receive attention from some major legacy brands, most notably Estee Lauder. Estee Lauder actually offered to buy the brand from Huber, who very quickly declined. He was worried that a huge company like Estee Lauder would come in and basically destroy the brand and the product that he created. However, Estee Lauder weren't having it. They didn't give up there. They wanted a piece of this action. They saw how good this Crème de la Mer was and they wanted the same thing for themselves. So they asked their senior chemist, Andrew Bevacqua, to try and recreate Crème de la Mer in 1886. But as much as he tried, he was unable to replicate anything even close to the effectiveness of Crème de la Mer. He was later quoted as saying, Crème de la Mer really does heal skin faster. I played around with the ingredients and created a cream that looked and smelled smelled like La Mer, but the results just weren't comparable. So Estee Lauder would have to wait for now. They would eventually get their hands on the brand, but not for another 9 years. It was very easy to see why they were so interested in La Mer though. Throughout the 80s and 90s, they just became more and more popular. They still had this mysterious appeal kind of behind them, and this almost small cult-like following grew into like this mass market following. And with the high price tag that came along with the luxury brand positioning, there was a lot of money to be made here. One listing in a mail order catalog in 1991 priced it at $85 an ounce, which is about 30 milliliters, so the size of what, like an average serum. That would be $196 in today's money for a pot of 30 milliliter moisturizing cream. That's Dr. Barbara Sturm kind of outrageous prices. Chapter 3, Max Huber dies, allegedly. Unfortunately for Dr. Huber, he didn't really get to enjoy his company's success and the vast amount of money it generated for as long as he may have liked, as he passed away in November of 1991. He was just 66 when he died, with the reason for his death still kind of being not fully known, but the Countess Lucien von Doz, who he became really close friends with, she stated that she believed it could have been down to a heart infection from a dental procedure, to quote her. Bizarrely though, so Dr. Huber's death would become one of the biggest mysteries surrounding the brand, with many believing that Dr. Huber may have faked his own death, or even more mysteriously, never even existed. Many have asked where his obituary is, if he actually died, and admittedly, we can't find one. There doesn't seem to be one anywhere online for the mysterious scientist. Others also point to a lack of information about him, a lack of evidence of his existence prior to Estee Lauder taking over. In fact, most people who don't believe Dr. Huber ever existed kind of think that this was all part of Estee Lauder's clever marketing for their launch of the brand. They believe he was just a character made up by the Estee Lauder marketing team. After all, the story of this mysterious rocket scientist, this captivating, engaging man who would attend all these like Hollywood parties and events for the elite, who healed his own burns and lived by the sea, and it was all very intriguing for consumers. The story of handpicked kelp being sound blasted and light pulses, and you know, it all seems to be adding to the story for the brand. And whilst this may be a conspiracy theory, to their credit, there are very few photos of Dr. Huber available, at least not ones that have been made available to the public. There don't appear to be any photos of him holding a jar of his famous cream that he was said to be touting all around the country at these huge events, wining and dining with Hollywood elite celebrities, the rich and famous. Like, they were photographed, but he wasn't. There's no pictures of his scars from this alleged accent, which you think would be like one of the main advertising and marketing things that he would use. You know, it all seems very mysterious. He was also apparently born in Germany, but no one really knows where or when he moved to the US, how he ended up in the US, and somehow rumors appear to have spread across the internet he worked for NASA, but there is no evidence he worked for NASA either. To this day, there isn't even a Wikipedia page for him. If you search for Max Huber, the only results you get is American football player, a Swiss graphic designer, or a Swiss diplomat. La Mer itself doesn't even have its own Wikipedia page. This does seem a little odd. Wikipedia has pages dedicated to breast-shaped hills, or even the cultural history of the bum, but no page dedicated to rocket scientists who created one of the most legendary, iconic skincare brands of all time. It's odd. It's very odd to me. I'm not a conspiracy theorist to a level, but this is bizarre. But saying that, there are also plenty of people who are happy to confirm that Dr. Huber was indeed real. We heard from the designers, Ralph Rucci, Linda Wells, a former beauty director of Glamour magazine, Felicia Milwitz, tells a similar story as they did. Talking about Dr. Huber, she is quoted as saying, "I was a young editor at Mademoiselle, and he told me he was a space scientist. He said he had a bad accident experimenting with aerospace, and I specifically remember saying, 'Are you injured? You don't look injured.' And he said, 'No, no, that's when I decided to do this cream. I couldn't find anything that would make it heal.' He said it took him 10 years. He also ate it in front of me. Now we see organic everything, but that was the beginning of it. His theory was, if I can eat it, it's good for me and it must be amazing for my skin." She says, "I only met him that once and I don't know about any of the conspiracy theories. Who knows, maybe I met someone else, but I sat with a man who claimed to be him and I was fascinated by him and told everyone about it." There's also Countess Lucien von Doz, who we spoke about earlier, she claimed that when she first started using Crème de la Mer, she thought it was so amazing that she called Dr. Huber to tell him how good it was. They would end up meeting when they were both in New York, and according to her, Dr. Huber would fall so madly in love with her that he would end up sending her 200 jars of Crème de la Mer at the time. Although many of the conspiracy theorists and skeptics don't quite trust the Countess as a reliable source, as after Estee Lauder relaunched La Mer, she would become the spokesperson for the brand. She also has her own slightly mysterious past, which some also claim to be fake, including supposedly marrying an Austrian count when she was 20, being close friends with Pavarotti, and allegedly dating Frank Sinatra. She sounds like a storyteller. Despite all the speculation and conspiracy and mysterious intrigue, it does appear that a man by the name of Maximilian Albert Huber did exist. Several journalists who kind of caught wind onto this conspiracy theory about the mysterious Dr. Huber managed to find an entry for his name in the official Californian death records, which stated that he passed away in Los Angeles on November the 5th, 1991. Although kind of unusually for a death record, it doesn't specify the cause of death, and it just kind of lists his place of birth as outside of the US. And although he may not have worked at NASA, he may have embellished his own story a little bit, there are records that he was a rocket scientist who actually worked for an aerospace company called CalVal Research and Development Corp. There are also records of a patent filed for Crème de la Mer in 1981 by a Maximilian Albert Huber. So although there are some things which seem unusual, it looks like Dr. Albert Huber did indeed exist and was the creator of Crème de la Mer. But the question of his existence wasn't the only mystery and wouldn't be the last in the history of Crème de la Mer. Chapter 4, Acquisition by Estee Lauder. According to Estee Lauder, when Dr. Huber died in 1991, he left his secrets of Crème de la Mer to his daughter, who he had tried to teach his methods over the years, but unfortunately, she found that she was unable to recreate his formulation to the same success. Kind of like when Estee Lauder tried to get that scientist, the cosmetic chemist, to recreate the formulation, they just couldn't. 4 years after his death, she finally accepted that her father's legacy and the company that he worked so hard to build would die if she didn't find help. Estee Lauder had maintained a strong interest in Crème de la Mer for many, many years, from when they first tried to buy it, from when they first tried to hack his product. So when Dr. Huber's daughter was ready to sell, they were the first company she approached. And in 1995, she agreed to deal with Estee Lauder for an undisclosed amount. And the hope was for Estee Lauder to use their vast marketing and distribution channels to expand the brand's reach more globally, whilst maintaining its luxury and exclusive image. But things weren't going to be that easy, because before they could do anything, they had to figure out how the fuck to create Crème de la Mer, how to create this miracle broth. They had all the ingredients, they had all the directions, I guess. They just couldn't get it. They just couldn't do it. When Andrew Bevacqua, Estee Lauder's senior chemist who had previously tried to recreate Crème de la Mer, arrived in California and saw where Huber had been making Crème de la Mer, he was shocked. He said, "It was the most bizarre thing I've ever seen." He said the room was lined with little buckets of cream. There were weird sounds and odors and pulsing light. "I spent 2 weeks with Max's daughter since she had stood by her father's side learning how to make La Mer. She taught me what he taught her." Armed with what he had learned, Bevacqua returned to Estee Lauder Labs to try and attempt to recreate the formula. As many people have pointed out over the years, the ingredients in a pot of Crème de la Mer are fairly similar to those in many other creams, Nivea in the blue tin being the main one that is always kind of compared to. The majority of the key ingredients are fairly standard and not special, but what makes it stand out is that sea kelp miracle broth. Bevacqua recreated the majority of the fermentation process that he had been taught, including the types of kelp used and other ingredients included, the quantities specified, but he admits that he was skeptical about the pulsing lights, the sound waves, you know, the sound recordings that the broth was exposed to, saying, "I was fascinated by the light and sound, but it didn't seem very scientific," saying that initially he left out those steps in the process, deeming them unnecessary, but the cream that he was producing just didn't seem to have the same healing qualities as the original versions. Estee Lauder by now had already announced their takeover. They had already announced their exclusive launch with Saks to take place a year after the takeover of the brand, and time was running out. They needed to get this miracle broth working. Joseph Gubernick, head of R&D and Bevacqua's boss at the time, told him to do exactly what the woman told you, to quote, referring to Huber's daughter. So reluctantly, he went back to the lab, started using the lights, the sound waves, the recordings as instructed, and things started to improve. When discussing it later, Bavakwa said, "I couldn't understand why it could be so necessary to do that. I thought creating the broth was enough. When Max's daughter told me about it, I thought she didn't understand because she wasn't a scientist," he said. But comparing the formulation to not using sound waves to using sound waves, he says the broth was much more active. Later research showed that the sound waves and pulse light act like a catalyst, speeding up and improving the fermentation process, resulting in a richer broth. But the resulting broth still wasn't producing the results it expected. It was better, but still not as good as the original. Gubernick and Bavakwa were getting desperate now. They couldn't work out what else they were missing. Like, what weren't they doing? They were following the directions. They were playing the cassette tape. They were doing the light show. So Gubernick decided to hire a psychic medium to consult with Huber from beyond the grave. After consulting with the psychic, Gubernick called Bavakwa into his office and handed him a piece of paper, a note, saying, "Max said you didn't do this." Supposedly, it was a note from Huber saying that the issue was with the way the ingredients were being heated. Bavakwa was obviously very confused about how Gubernick had been talking to Dr. Huber, who had been dead for 5 years. But at this point, he was just like, "I just need to try anything. As crazy as it sounds, I need to try whatever." And as crazy as it sounds, the tip worked. So he changed the heat, and tests on the resulting cream showed that had similar anti-inflammatory healing properties as the original version, and even got approval from many of Dr. Huber's close friends and original clients and customers who Estee Lauder bought in to make sure that it was up to the standard that they had come to expect. The relaunch of Crème de la Mer went as planned, ahead as scheduled, and everyone's delighted. Estee Lauder, diehard fans who thought the cream was never coming back. Bavakwa later said that Lauder called it a miracle broth because we know how well it works, but also it was a miracle that we made it. Chapter 5, Brand Expansion and Innovation. The relaunch of La Mer through Estee Lauder was a huge success. It truly brought the brand to the globe, to everyone around the world. And they would continue to expand over the coming years with the launch of new products, including their Eye Concentrate, the Lifting Contour Serum, the Moisturizing Soft Cream, broadening the brand's portfolio. And whilst La Mer has expanded its product line and embraced modern skincare, innovations, ingredients, and technologies, it retains the traditional techniques and the core philosophy established by Dr. Huber. And they continue to take inspiration from Huber's early work and the pioneering vision for the brand, and La Mer's history of consulting with supernatural practitioners would continue as well. Whilst developing a new product, Gubernick hired a healer to go into their labs. The healer would work on one vat of a new product and left the others untouched. And apparently in consumer testing, more people liked the one that the healer had worked on. They then got the healer to imprint her energy onto the tools that they used to create the products so that they could recreate the effect. And in 2016, catching on to the trend of makeup that also provides skincare benefits, La Mer launched their own makeup line, Skin Color de La Mer, which included a foundation, a concealer, an ultra-fine loose powder, all of which contained the brand's unique Miracle Broth. They have also continued the practice of starting each new batch of broth by using a small portion of the previous broth. And apparently, all products La Mer makes to this day contain a broth that can be traced back to the batch Bavakwa discovered in Huber's office when Estee Lauder took over. And the recording Huber used to play of the previous fermentation bubbling sounds still plays in La Mer's labs today. And their focus on innovation, but also tradition and whatever Dr. Huber was doing, has been very successful for them, with the brand reaching a valuation of $1 billion in 2018. Chapter 6, Controversies and Criticisms. The brand's impressive growth wasn't completely smooth, and they certainly received their fair share of criticism. La Mer's come under fire for many for not being cruelty-free, and interestingly, La Mer does not list its animal testing policy on their website, but when animal activist rights reached out to La Mer for confrontation regarding their animal testing policies, they received the following response. La Mer does not test on animals, and we never ask others to do so on our behalf. If a regulatory body demands it for its safety or regulatory assessment, an exception can be made. made. Our consumers can be certain that we are committed to producing only the highest quality beauty products which meet our exacting efficiency, safety, and ethical standards. They say we have a deep commitment to the abolishment of animal testing. Decades ago, we were one of the first beauty companies to prove that safety can be validated by means other than animal testing. We kind of see this with L'Oreal as well, being one of the key players in selling in, we're talking about China here, right? China used to be one of the countries where it was required by law to have your products tested on animals if you are selling in mainland China, selling from outside of China. The law has changed and it is changing. And like L'Oreal, it seemed like La Mer were one of those brands who were one of the biggest brands actually financially donating to changing those animal testing laws and procedures in China. However, back then, you know, way back when, that wasn't necessarily the case. So like back then, their cruelty-free claims kind of fell apart when they started selling in China. So yes, whilst the law has changed now, whilst that may not be the case for new brands going into China, this wasn't necessarily the case way back when. So yes, they couldn't really call themselves a cruelty-free brand when selling in China. However, laws have changed. Another controversy would hit in 2018 when a Chinese beauty blogger named Hao Yu, whose nickname is Dr. Big Mouth, announced on Weibo, the Chinese version of Twitter kind of thing, that he was suing beauty giant Estee Lauder as the owner of La Mer. The blogger accused La Mer of making false claims about the efficacy of their moisturizing cream and lying to its Chinese customers. After posting a message to his 1.2 million Weibo followers saying, "Yin Yang website, fake ads, La Mer, how long are you going to lie to Chinese consumers?" He then stated that he would be suing the company for a refund of $844 in damages and with a demand that Estee Lauder publish a public apology in a Chinese newspaper. Now, his lawsuit comes from the claim that the language used on La Mer's Chinese website is misleading consumers into believing that Crème de la Mer can heal scars from burns, which is kind of La Mer's claim to fame, right? It's their origin story. However, when comparing the website descriptions to the US and Japanese versions of La Mer website, they don't talk about burns. They just say it has a soothing ability. But on the Chinese website, they say that it can heal burns. And this was a really personal and sensitive topic for him. He told followers that he spent $211 on Crème de la Mer and used it on his scars that he had from burns, but he never saw any improvement. He said that he also found that other Chinese customers who had bought the cream for healing scars from burns felt that they had been tricked into buying this product, claiming that the brand had purposely exaggerated its claims to Chinese consumers on their Chinese website, which would be a clear violation of the Chinese advertising law. Yu's post very quickly went viral, receiving more than 34,000 comments with almost 100,000 shares. And a hashtag about La Mer trying to deceive Chinese consumers even began trending, and Yu's original post was viewed more than 79 million times. In a statement to Vox, who wrote an article on the controversy, La Mer said, "We stand behind our products and will take action to vigorously defend our brand against these allegations." For decades, consumers around the world have been devoted to La Mer because of their confidence in its efficacy and quality. Yu later responded with a blog post saying that no matter how much money Chinese consumers have and spend on cosmetics, big global brands will never treat Chinese customers as VIPs. He says, "In their eyes, we are still gullible sheep waiting to be killed." It's not clear if Yu ever went forward with the lawsuit and what came of it, but this wasn't good PR for La Mer, especially in China, the world's largest growing market for luxury beauty products. Although it received a lot of attention, it definitely wasn't the first time people had questioned the truth behind La Mer's bold claims, with many questioning for years if the product was really even worth the eye-watering price tag. Chapter 7. Is La Mer even worth it? Despite being loved by the rich and famous who think nothing of spending hundreds and hundreds of dollars on a single cream, there are plenty who have called out the brand for being overpriced, inaccessible, and lacking transparency. La Mer certainly isn't cheap, with the lip balm alone setting you back $80, with the legendary iconic Crème de la Mer costing you $570 alone, and you could spend even more money and get your name engraved on the jar, which is really, really nice for people with money. But when the ingredients to make Crème de Mer reportedly only cost around $20, this level of markup seems pretty outrageous. And the worst part of it all really is their much loved eye concentrate. We mentioned will cost you $270 for a tiny 50 milliliter jar. That's over 3 times as expensive as their Crème de la Mer. Not only that, but a quick look at the reviews on the US website show that customers are far from happy with the product. When my researcher had a look at the reviews, the most recent 8 reviews gave it a 1-star rating. The 9th rating wasn't even that good. They gave it 3 stars. The next one was straight back to 1 star. The majority of those reviews even claimed that the product made their eyelids swollen and itchy, or they even suffered some kind of like chemical burn from using it. Those definitely aren't the kind of results that you'd expect from a luxury skincare product you paid hundreds of dollars for. And it's stories like that, reviews like that, that have led people to look for much more affordable alternatives on the market. With some people comparing Crème de la Mer to the Nivea Blue Jar moisturizer. La Mer claims to be so expensive because the products are so labor intensive. The kelp is hand harvested in small boats of 3 to 4 divers before being put on ice and shipped in small quantities back to Melville, according to the brand. Each batch of the Miracle Broth takes up to 3 months to make. Lime tea, another key ingredient, takes 6 weeks to brew. Then the original cream has to be hand filled at a certain temperature. And to be fair to La Mer, even if the fermentation process sounds like a bit sci-fi, a bit alien to you, to me too, there are studies that show seaweed does have hydrating benefits to the skin. I love sea kelp personally. I love red algae. I love all that kind of stuff in my skincare. Dr. Joshua Zeichner, the director of cosmetic and clinical research in the Department of Dermatology at Mount Sinai Hospital, explains that seaweed kelp is rich in minerals and is also known to have the benefit in wound healing. In addition to this, in 2023, La Mer's Max Huber Research Labs published a research paper, their own, claiming that their Crème de la Mer moisturizer containing the fermented sea kelp extract improved the appearance of multiple aging signs. This paper was presented to the World Congress of Dermatology, where the findings were apparently confirmed by the independent dermatologists. But of course, with any brand who conducts their own research, we have to take this with a pinch of salt. The research was conducted in their own labs. Some people don't love their kind of like steeped in tradition creams, but in an article for the Daily Mail, the founder of Paula's Choice, Paula herself, who continues to review products and is renowned for her in-depth research of cosmetic products and, you know, created Paula's Choice. She says it's just a really dated formula, something straight out of the 70s. She says product formulations have become much more sophisticated since then. Estee Lauder itself has gone on to develop skincare that is far better than Crème de la Mer and doesn't cost as much. Personally, I understand the want and need for luxury skincare. I understand the want for luxury in all different aspects of life. I do not equate that to having to spend a lot of money for good, effective skincare. La Mer, for me, has just never piqued an interest for me. As I mentioned, its history to me is more interesting than the products themselves, because I hear that they're average. Whilst there's only one person, Ola, who could actually convince me to even try Crème de la Mer, even my business budget doesn't quite meet the price tags yet. I don't think I'll be investing that much into it yet. So it's still questionable whether these luxury price tags are worth it or not. Subjective, right? But I just hope that the healing claims are at least true, or, you know, people do really love this brand for a reason and are buying it for a reason. Because if the reviews for the eye concentrate are anything to go by, these products aren't great. Chapter 8, Future of the Brand. Despite all the controversies and criticism surrounding La Mer, they have done some good. In 2005, the brand began an 8-year partnership with Oceana to support marine protected areas. The partnership resulted in protection of 16.1 million square miles of seafloor habitats, which is great. In 2010, they released their first limited edition Blue Heart Crème de la Mer, with part of the profits going towards supporting marine protection and in raising awareness to the issues our oceans face. They've also made significant strides in sustainable packaging and ethical sourcing of ingredients, with over 90% of sea plants used in their products now being sustainably sourced. So despite the controversies and its kind of weird, bizarre history, La Mer has done an amazing job at building its own legacy as one of the most luxurious, most coveted skincare brands in the world, with celebrities like Beyonce, Kim Kardashian, Nicole Kidman, Blake Lively, all talking about this brand, unsponsored, unpaid. They're not paid to endorse. So, you know, they appear in nearly every celebrity's skincare routine. They don't really need a marketing budget at this point. So regardless of the price tag, the controversies, and whether the products actually work or not, it doesn't take a psychic to tell you that La Mer isn't going anywhere anytime soon.